Okay, good morning class again. So we are going to start the revision program part 2. So we have from limited liability company we stopped last time. So limited liability companies, you know, there are two limited liability companies. We normally talk about the private limited companies and public limited companies. We talk about the private company advantages and disadvantages, and we talk about the main features of the private and public limited companies, the documentations and everything you need to register. Talk about the, there are two main documents to register a limited liability company, namely AOA, Articles of Association, and MOA, Memorandum of Association. These are the features on the MOA and AOA. We talk about that day. And private limited companies, advantages, disadvantages. Right, we talk about that. Limited liability companies owned by friends and family members. Therefore, the control cannot be lost to outsiders. More capital can be raised. Status is there for the business owner. However, limited liability companies have some disadvantages as well. For example, the cost and time it takes to set up, and financial information has to be made public. And those cannot raise large amount of money like PLCs. These are the limitations of the private limited companies. After that, we talk about the PLCs as well. Public limited companies is a way, the going public, I told you, is going expensive. Large amount of capital can be raised. All the PLCs in stock exchange is known as the public limited companies. You can see a large amount of capital can be raised. Shareholders have limited liability. PLCs can exploit economies of scale, maybe dominate the market, and then they have high profile in the media. These things are the main advantage of PLCs. However, there are disadvantages as well. Setup cost expensive, going public expensive, more financial information made public, more regulatory control from the government and managers may control than the shareholders. This is the limitations of the public limited companies. Even though there are limitations, there is always benefit outweigh the disadvantages. And talk about the main features. We are going to introduce multinational companies there. A multinational company is a large business with significant production or service operations in at least two different countries. That's at least two different countries. There are production and service operations. There are at least two operations, two different countries. So features we are going to introducing here, because we have a separate chapter to discuss about the multinationals' advantages and disadvantages. The main features of multinational companies like Coca-Cola and everything, British Petroleum, Microsoft, these companies like McDonald's and Toyota, British Petroleum, these biggest companies in the world, they have huge asset base. One feature, have qualified experienced staff and powerful and advertising marketing capability. And fourth one, highly advanced and up-to-date technology they are using, like latest technology they can purchase, and highly influential both economically and politically. These are the main features of multinational companies we talk about. And then and also we talk about another important two features, very efficient in the exploit huge economies of scale. Therefore, multinational companies are very efficient, and ownership and control is centered to the host country. That's another thing to talk about. So ownership and control goes to the host country. Most of the multinationals are located in the USA, right? So and then we talk about the you can go to the next part. There's public cooperation. So now private sector organizations are okay. Now we are going to talk about the mainly public corporations, the features and the mainly advantages and disadvantages, and also privatization, all that publicly owned, government owned business organizations. So in the public corporations, we talk about mainly public corporation main objective is the social welfare. So the features of public corporations are mainly, you can see it is owned by state, the government, and is created by a law, and it's having incorporation status because the responsibility always goes to the government, always incorporated. They're separate control there from apart from the owners, and then provide public services mainly, like, you know, utilities like electricity, water, gas, transportation, health system, and everything like national healthcare system. Sometimes it can be transportation or travel, like, you know, television and everything, mass media. So these are public services, and public accountability is there because it is taken the taxpayers' money. Finally, can see budget and everything. They allocate billions of money for those things to run out this organization for a particular years. And you can see we talk about the main reasons why public ownership is important. Public ownership is important because of the, to avoid wasteful duplication in some industries. Sometimes private sector, without any limitation, they actually put, you know, duplicate industries they are starting. As a result, you can see monopoly power is creating, and as a result, so to avoid the wasteful duplication, we have to start the public sector and also maintain control of strategic industries like, you know, harbor, airport, and aviation, and some industries, you know, like Sri Lankan, like any country, you can see defense system and the aviations and the transportation, harbor, import, export. These are strategic infrastructure locations. Therefore, to maintain and control the strategic industries, we need to have the government participation, public participation, and to save jobs, we need to have some kind of to save jobs. The public sector, we need to have the public sector to give some job opportunities to people and fill gaps left by the private sector. Sometimes private sector not providing some facilities to rural areas because not profitable in that particular area to operate because of the lack of income of the people or lack of population. But public sector will provide facilities for the all that gaps that we fill, because public sector, they are working not for a profit but for the public welfare. Therefore, even though, like, imagine, think about the area, whether they have only limited amount of population, but there's no source of way of, like, going to, you know, town or something, transportation provision. So government can put a bus transportation mechanism where private sector are not willing to do, because private sector, if they put some vehicle, this will be costly for them, because even you can't cover the cost of the petrol or diesel cost can't even cover. But normally public sector not like that. They are transportation, they are earning sometimes losses, sometimes very small income they are earning, but they are operating to give the provision of the service. And serve unprofitable regions, that's another reason why public sector is important. When we talk about the criticism of public ownership of business, main criticisms are against the public ownership is cost to the government. The costing part of the government, because the public sector activities are very expensive these days, you know, millions of billions of money they are allocating for different things from taxpayers' money. It's a burden for the government, so it should be, again, what happened. They have to take a loan and everything to actually to provide that thing. And you can see, if you heard yesterday, in Sri Lanka also, we have a budget talk was there. There was a huge budget deficit. Huge budget deficit was there, about 2,000 billion budget deficit. Government tax revenue is not enough actually to cover the cost of the government. That's how it has happened. Even Australia also same. Even other countries also same. They have billions and trillions of deficit is there. Deficit is where the expenses are greater than the revenue. Another one is inefficiency. The inefficiency is another disadvantage, criticism for the government sector. They always say government organizations are always failure. Government hospitals, government buses, government transportation, government media, government offices, everything failure, inefficient compared to private sector. So, but however, they will provide some service of the organization. So then inefficiency is another thing, the poor reliability and regular lateness of trains and everything can be caused to this situation. But some countries are there, very efficient service they are providing. And another criticism for government ownership is the political interference. Political interference provided by them. So public sector corporations often suffer the government interference, always with the ministers and the president to the prime minister to everyone. They are going to interfere in different layers of the government. They are asking to change systems, and sometimes they are putting their employees into organizations, make the excess staff. So as a result of that, political interference make this government actually become very public corporation, is increase the prices, generate more revenue. Political interference will be the main threat in a lot of Asian countries like India, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, and all that thing. And also difficult to control the corruption and everything. And the difficult to control is another aspect of that thing. Some public sector corporations are very large, and they may be employing many thousands of workers spread across a wide geographical area and own huge quantities of physical assets. This might take it difficult to coordinate different parts of the business and run it effectively. For example, the NHS in UK employ about 1.5 million people, right? As biggest employer in the world with such large workforce and so many different operational locations are there, managing the organizations can be very challenging, guys. So difficult to control. As in Sri Lanka, we have a large organization like that. Difficulty of controlling, that's another criticism happened. So as a result of that, what the solution they are giving is to privatize. Privatization is transfer of public sector resources to the private sector business. So public to private resource transferring known as a privatization. So privatization can take place in a number of forms. First one, a sale of public corporations. You can sell the organization for millions and billions of money. You can see here also we have sold our so much of like a company, Sri Lankan Telecom. You can see Sri Lankan Airlines, Ceylon Glass Corporations, and Ceylon, you can see the paper corporation, and then like so much of corporations are there, government-owned corporations, we sold to the private sector businesses. 50% or more than 51% of the stake, we sold it to the private sector. You can see now Sri Lankan Airlines is owned by Emirates right now. Like that, there are typical examples are there, they're selling. Another one is deregulation. If you can't sell it, you can deregulate even. Then private sector also can come without any rules and regulation. They can participate easily. They also can actually do the things that the government are doing. For example, they should allow more private sector to come in the fields like financial sector, banking, financial insurance. So deregulation, not only the government, they must have a private sector participation as well. That's why I call the deregulation. And contracting out, give you some activities to third parties. You can see a good example, you can see Sri Lanka, like the CMC, Colombo Municipal Council, the garbage handling, the janitors activities are going to Abans company, private sector. They have given the contracting out those, the garbage handling, like a waste management sector section. And then the sale of land and property. You can see recently how much of land and everything we sold it to the Chinese government. Sale of land and property, like you can see all the Gold Face Green projects and the Hambantota and all the places, selling lands and property to the foreign countries. So even for the private sector businessmen or something. So they mainly examples was the selling of land and property to the private sector with the generous discounts. Okay, why does the privatization take place? Privatization take place because of the different these reasons: to generate income to the government and to reduce inefficiency to the public. These are the main reasons to generate income, to reduce the inefficiencies and everything, and also as a result of the deregulation and to reduce the political interference, we need to actually privatize everything. So privatization have a good and bad side, based, but very, very debatable. Recently, you can see Sri Lankan government has not privatized anything, but mainly it was there long time, it was there Sri Lanka, not only Sri Lanka, a lot of countries are doing this privatization mechanism, right? That's all about private public sector businesses. Let's move on. Appropriate of different forms of ownership. We talk about some features. When you're selecting a sole trader or partnership or private company or something, you have to think about some factors affecting the appropriate of business. What are those factors? The growth potential. If you want to grow fast, you can go for start like a company. It's better to start a company than a sole trader. You have high growth potential. Size of the company, that was another important thing. If you have want to increase the size of the organization, start to make a private company and PLC level. The need for finance, if you want to raise more capital, then you can go for a public private PLC option or partnership option. Controlling power, if you want to keep the control with you or family and member, then you can start private company or sole trader level if you want to do everything alone. Limited liability, best decision is to go to start a limited liability company, like private company or public company. Right? And there are other factors as well. Sometimes it's a legal status or what are the business, what they want to plan to do with the profits and everything. Finally, the different stakeholder perspective, the employee perspective, shareholder perspective, customers, different perspective. So there are main objective of the government, mainly small business they wanted to. We have some objective, something like no organization to have some objective, like no private sector, they want to maximize the profit, or so survival is their main objective. And family business and everything, they want to have to keep the control with them. That's another objective. Most multinational companies, they want to grow. That's their main objectives. So you can see this private sector organizations, these are the main objectives we talk about in that lesson. Okay, move on. Classification of business. This is like one of our, in the beginning we start this lesson actually, remember. There are four categories of business are there. Primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary. primary business means agriculture business. You can see the first photo, which businesses organization doing a farming, fishing, agriculture, quarry, mining activities going on. We are taking the resource from the nature itself, earth. So that's called farming and fishing, agriculture, everything coming under primary sector. And secondary sector means you can see the manufacturing sector. You can see food processing or something, converting the raw materials into finished or semi-finished goods coming under secondary sector. And then tertiary sector involving provision of the services. You can see the transportation and the warehousing, banking, insurance, transportation, advertising, everything coming under tertiary sector. And other one, quaternary sector means, you know, app designing, smartphone, you know, think something like, you know, technology using like genetically modified things, you know, science and technology, the IT field, you know, like something like a software development and the games development, app developers, like research and development. So you can see now new like a COVID-19, like a vaccine was released by the Moderna company from, you know, USA, and then they are like, I think 94.5% successful rate is there. So we'll see, that's kind of a coming from as a result of the quaternary sector, right? So they are using some kind of, like, I can see that that vaccines was developed, and then like there are millions of people there, now people are dying. We'll see what we can do with that vaccine. If it's successful, we can actually save the world. Okay, another one is the primary sector. Primary sector talk about this thing, actually production involving extraction of raw materials from the earth, agriculture, fishing, forestry, mining, quarrying, everything. Secondary sector we define as the production of involving conversion of raw materials into finished and semi-finished goods. Assembly lines and manufacturing plants are example of this. And tertiary sector examples, you can see the provision of services to the economy, commercial services, financial services, household services are the example of this, and leisure services, professional services, transport and everything coming under the service sector. And we talk about the interdependence between these firms. Yes, these sectors are interdependent with each other. Primary sector provides this output to secondary sector. After secondary sector provision and everything, they are going to sell it to the tertiary sector. And then tertiary sector, they are selling that in supermarkets and everything. And quaternary sector supporting all the activities by making softwares and everything, and computer systems and technology infrastructure provided by them. And there's a trend is there called deindustrialization. These days, a lot of people are removing their, can see 1950s, a lot of people are producing agriculture. 24% people are working in the agricultural field. But when it comes to 2015, 5 years ago, it's only 1.5% only the population who are involved in the primary sector. That's called the deindustrialization. And the industrialization, you can see the 42% going down to 24%. And we can see there's a huge expansion of the tertiary sector. 32% now boom to 74%, like a 2/3 of the economy, no, 3/4 of the economy, they are moving actually tertiary sector, which is provision of service, because it's easier than doing agriculture job, doing industry job, because agriculture industry jobs are a little bit tough working conditions, no, we have to work in the field, no air condition. But tertiary sector jobs are not like that, no, these are very easy, convenient, and have a stable salary, everything. But these organizations, they don't have stable income like agriculture. If you become a farmer, fisherman, you know, there's no stable income for you. So these are the main advantages we talk about, the reasons for declining this thing. Sometimes people become more educated because the competition increase, and then advanced technology came. So they want to spend more time on leisure activities than the manufacturing and everything, people. That's right, because people become more educated and they don't want to involve in the this one. Right, okay, let's move on the location. Right, we talk about the, I think the final like a week, we talked about last week about the location decisions. When you're selecting a business location, you have to think about really important factors. Business location, if it's an organization who are doing manufacturing, agriculture, you have to think about the climate factor, definitely, né? The climate conditions and the quality of the land and everything, is it a fertile land or not, the weather conditions and everything, you have to be very focused. It's a manufacturing company, you have to think about the proximity to the market. Proximity in the sense of closeness to the market, né? Closeness to the labor. Proximity to labor is another factor you have to concern about. Proximity to material, if manufacturing unit or the materials to transportation and everything. So you can use the materials to be closer to, if you can find a location where there is a lot of materials are there, you can find them. In the given case study, you can see whatever the case study coming, you must be able to apply this knowledge. So this is our example. There's a like one of our past paper. They say there's a party house, something like a for kids and everything. They are organizing like a place to celebrate their birthdays and everything. So what are the factors you have to consider when located that? You can see parking facilities located in a metropolitan area, ne, closer to the market, and then having some other infrastructure, some nice scenery and everything. You can see the about the photos and everything. So these things are the main thing you have to think about, like when you're doing that proximity to labor, proximity to market, everything. So apply to the case study. So by remembering these factors, not enough. What in whatever the situation, whatever the given scenario, you must be able to apply, guys. If it's a surgery sector, if it's a primary sector, if it's a vegetable supplier, you must think about the proximity material, access to water, and access to the climate. You can see the proper climate must be there, and proximity to computer, sometimes other thing. Proximity to computer, sometimes they wanted to be closer to the computer because then only a lot of customers are coming, then they can have a variety of competition. A lot of customers will visit your organization to ask him prices and everything. Another one, you can see the nature of business activity. The nature of business activity, you can see the sometimes the service provision. You think about the traffic and congestion. Like service business, mainly you think about the car park facility, no? With a supermarket. You have to think about the car parking and everything. If it's a shopping mall or something, parking is the number one. Otherwise, congestion will become. And then you think about the waste traffic controlling, everything. Choose the location where there is like a low chance of delaying and everything. It's the most important factor. And office-based business, you have to think about the giving the people this facility like food, shelter, clothes and everything. Not only them, office-based business sometimes they have a facilities must be there to visitors to access the range of facilities like cinema, theater, museum, nightclubs, bars, sports stadium. Everything must be location nearby. So a lot of offices are located nearby those facilities. You can see like London, Paris, Dubai, New York also. These are very good organizations, like locations for businesses. Manufacturing and processing business must be there. You know, like a especially coal mine or nuclear plantation, something must be away from the public, must be away from the local people because it will be dangerous. Therefore, must have the, those facilities, the coastal lines, beach, and if sometimes we need a like a need something like a refining part. Sometimes, you know, if you want to straight away from the ships and everything, you have to take the oil and everything. Some from their pipes and everything, you can actually take that oil and everything from the tank oils, and they will send their oil and everything to your factory. Refining plants are there to occupy the coastal locations. Manufacturers need very large areas of land. May choose location where land is relatively cheap. A lot of space near edge of the towns and cities. So if it's a nuclear plant or something, definitely should be a isolated area where no residents are there because it's very radioactive elements are there. Agricultural lands must have a huge space. That's why Colombo, I mean, that's not a good place for agriculture. Why? Huge population density. You don't have a land that much. But if you go to the northern side of our country, you can see there are so much of agricultural land in Polonnaruwa and Radhapura and all the areas. The acres of lands are there. So people have a lot of the people they are doing that agricultural activities are going on that place. But in Colombo area, we can see we don't have that much of land in Sri Lanka in the Colombo side because of population and the factories and residential areas are there in congested in Colombo area. It's like that. New York and everything, you can't see in USA agricultural field. But if you go to the other side, no, other part of the like a countryside of the USA, you can see like there are so much of big agricultural lands you can see. But if you come to big cities like no, California, New York, like a cities like that, states like that, we can't see that much of agricultural land. Similar here also. Another factor we're talking about is mainly the impact of internet nowadays for a location. A lot of business organization, you know, they don't need to have a location now because of the internet. Everything actually, because mobility of labor going down, a lot of people right now, you can see they are using internet to order something. You can see everyone nowadays, they're actually using internet facilities to do everything, mobile banking, to mobile shopping, everything. Because of that, because of specifically because of COVID-19 actually boost that situation again. But now a lot of people were actually having some kind of like a new normal, is everything doing online. You can see now this online schooling thing and online, now everything goes online, viral. And then as a result of that, we can see now entrepreneurs are becoming more important. They have mainly thinking about the internet and location vision. So internet will be very, very important factor nowadays. E-commerce, you can see largest, the richest person in the world is a owner of internet company, internet based business, Amazon, Jeff Bezos. So his net worth like more than like now 130-140 billion, right, from internet. So everything, you see other like rich people in the world also internet based big giants, you know, Microsoft owner Bill Gates, always the number two from long time, using the always top 10. And then the recent one, the Facebook social media king Mark Zuckerberg, who owns the WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, and everything. So he's world, I think, fifth richest person right now. Like there's a lot of internet based business are the people, you can see, not only him, even a lot of people are moving. You can see, we check the list, so many people, Jack Ma, Alibaba, and then other people like, you know, people who owns the Oracle company, the Larry Ellison. So these are the good examples. And Tesla company, there's another technology side business like that. So so much of like billionaires are mainly nowadays, they are moving into the, they become billionaires by the software and the technology industries. So as a result of that, we can see the internet have a so much of important for location, because you don't need to have a, to purchase a fixed premises, you don't need to pay rent, and then they could run their business any form, anywhere in the world from internet with their internet connection. Only thing, you must have a particular website and the customer must be able to take that service. And then you can easily do that, take the service, and you can buy anything online, and you can, they will deliver home. So these are the main thing, the connectivity factor. You can see available to computers and other electronic equipments, another important factor, internet and everything like social media, internet is another important factor for location. Another one is legal control. Sometimes location decision will be involved by legal control, sometimes traffic congestion, and minimize the pollution, and the pharmaceutical petrochemical companies like encourage manufacturing to locate where unemployment is high, and then government use the financial incentive to influence the business and all that thing, and attract foreign manufacturers to the country. These are the main, sometimes some government, both local and national, may try to influence the location decisions on for several reasons. These are the main reasons why legal controls are there. After you want to bring foreign investors to country, foreign direct investment, and everything in order to boost the economy, right? So it, location is really important. Business location, you can see the geographical area, proximity to market, proximity to customers, proximity to labor, proximity to materials, everything is important. And also geopolitics also important. You can see Sri Lanka is a very strategic location for a lot of countries. India, China, USA, always, they are always keen to looking at Sri Lanka because of our, we are like a pearl of the Indian Ocean. Yeah, Indian Ocean power in the Sri Lanka. So the harbor and everything. So, and not only that, you can see the globalization, everything we are going to do in separately. You can see now, out of the this chapters, you can see what we have to do this term mainly. So far from, you can see the section number one. So business activity we have done, business objectives we have done, sole traders, partnerships, social enterprises we have, franchises we have completed, limited liability companies, multinational companies we have done, public corporations completed, appropriate different forms of ownership completed, classification of business, primary secondary completed, decisions of location completed. Okay, so after that we have to complete the location, after location decisions, chapter number 8, again we have to talk about the measuring success in business, measuring success in business. And not only that, we talk about the, remember that labor intensive, capital intensive lesson also we done that after chapter 14. We have to go through this chapter as well, the factors of production, chapter 44. Factor 44, so we have learned land, labor, capital and entrepreneurship, division of labor, capital intensive, labor intensive, that chapter also we have done the first term, remember. Okay, let's move on to the last two chapters then to revise, right? So measuring success in business. So measuring success in business, you can see what are the measures of judging success. That's another important chapter we have completed. You can see measuring success, there are certain factors we are talking, the revenue, market share, customer satisfaction, profit, growth, shareholder satisfaction, employee satisfaction, everything. These are the measures of judging success. When organization they are doing business, we have to find out whether the business is successful or not. This factor we can find out by looking at these factors. You can see measures of success. You can see the revenue. If you have revenue, high growth rate like this, you can see step by step revenue ups and downs, ups and but they keep moving on. High growth rate is there, we call this a business is successful business. Market share also same. If you have a good market share apart with the industry with the other rivals, that means if you have a large number of market share, we call that business is successful business. That's why a lot of people, a lot of customers are like to engage with this business. Profitability is another important element of judging success. How much profit after tax you can earn. So a lot of companies, if you are making profit, mean apparently are successful because your business can survive very well and you have enough money to save also profitability. But sometimes some businesses are survival level, they don't have enough profit. Sometimes businesses are loss making. So when the loss making start, business eventually they will close the business because you can't operate the business with the loss making scenario. So profit margin is really important. So profitability is the main thing, like a spirit of the business, profit. That's all business people they wanted to earn. This is the reason behind the success of the organization, profitability. If you have used the profit, you can use the profit for different scenario. You can use the profit for give a good competition in the market. You can invest that profit. And you can expand the size of the business by the profit you earn. And also profit can be compared with other business. We can find out who earned the most profit, who's the number one in the industry profitability wise. And it's like this is the main advantage of profit. But some people are there, they don't want to maximize, but they want to have like a modest profit because profit satisfies in business people. But mainly a lot of business organizations want to maximize it. Ne? Profitability is like that kind of like a beautiful thing you can earn at the end of the business. Some like a social objective business, mainly social businesses, welfare businesses, they don't want to earn any profit because of their objective is not the profit, but the customers and members' welfare. You can see other factors like growth factors and these factors. You can see growth of the company can be determined by these turnover, revenue, number of employees, market share, and amount of capital employed, and European definition of size. These factors you can see this table, no need to buy hard guys, but just have some kind of idea, right? Turnover means sales revenue, income. In micro level, less than 2 million euro, and small business, less than 10 million. If it's a medium, less than 10, more than 10, more than less than 50, 10 to 50, large business greater than 50. Like that, that's how the European Union classify the size of the business. Number of employees also, you can see less than 10, micro level. If you have less than 50, that's small business. It's like a 50 to 250 is medium size, and greater than 249, that's large business. That's how they classify the business based on the number of employees, the payroll, how many labors are depending on you. Capital employed wise, you can see less than 2 million capital, then micro. If less than 10 million, small, is between 10 to 43, we call medium size. More than 43, we call large business. Like that, guys, you can find out the different size of the organization. So other one you can see the owners and shareholder satisfaction. Another important thing is owner satisfaction, how they will feel about the business. Do shareholders judge the success of the business? Most shareholders, a private company, they want to have know the dividend. The size of the dividend is a key element of their success. If they're earning a huge dividend of the organization, then we can find out the organization is really successful because the organization can earn a good return for their investment than the bank. So shareholder satisfaction is a really important thing. You can see the company dividend wise, dividend per share increasing apparently. It's a good indication that this company has a huge growth rate, success rate. Then only you can think, okay, share prices of the Yahoo, BMW share prices, you can see that also rising trend from 2012 to 16, 4 years. If I'm a shareholder, I might invest in more and more. I'm holding this share because it's a guaranteed that shareholder, as a shareholder, I prefer to increase the value of my share and get the more dividend from the company. This is the main concerns of the shareholders from a company. And other thing is actually the employee satisfaction. From the employee's perspective, we can judge a company satisfied because the company is successful if the employees judge their company is a good company, like ease to get promotion, and then maximize the financial rewards and welfare, giving training opportunities, fair and honest treatment, opportunities for promotion and everything coming under that. So therefore, imports of targets also really important, right? Not only that, some media, certificates and awards received by the business, that also are measures of judging success. And setting targets are really important. If you achieve the targets, you can see, okay, last year I set a target to earn 10 billion profit. Okay, this year actually I earn 12 billion profit. That means I'm successful. I earn more than my target. Like that, you can have some kind of like an objective with you, and you can find out whether you achieve the objective, then you are successful. So let's move on to the last chapter 368, page number. You can see the division of labor and everything, the factors of production lesson that we talk about is easy lesson, the final revision lesson before the examination. You can see there are four factors of production, guys: land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. Land, you have to pay rent. Capital, you have to pay interest. Labor, you have to pay wages. And enterprise, you have to, organization will get the profit. So enterprise is the entrepreneurship factor who combine all these factors by taking a risk. So guys, just go through my short notes and my handouts, go through their definitions, go through their advantage, disadvantage, features and everything. Learn these things. And then also we talk about the labor intensive and capital intensive, the specialization and division of labor. Please go through the advantage and disadvantages of that. Division of labor is good. Productivity will improve as a result of that. They can concentrate on by one work again and again, repetition. Same work, they will become specialized. Time will be saved, and then organization production will be easier. However, they will get what? Professional diseases. Because of specialization, these poor people, what happened? They will get doing it again and again. Monotony, the boredom, fatigue will come for them. Then professional diseases. My eyesight can be weakened. You can see, I know that now also, right? Because of the online thing, because of, I know some parents are worried about their children because they are spending too much of time on the behind front of the computer screen. So the eyesight can be weakened, and start headaches and everything. I know so much of cases like that. This is the professional diseases coming because of that, because we used to have a physical lessons normally. Now, because we have to do in front of a computer, then as a result of that, you can see what happened to eyesight, right? Even not only you, it might, right? Everyone, teachers, students, same thing for everyone. And also finally, the labor intensive and capital intensive we talk about. If the organization occupy more labor than capital, we call labor intensive. And if you have more capital compared with the labor, we call machine non-capital intensive. And talk about this organization, just go to this capital intensive, labor intensive table, advantages and disadvantages. I'm sure you can do it. You can actually, a capital intensive business organization, generally you have low cost. More cost is there, like a capital intensive, more cost is there initially, high productivity, because machine not asking any breaks, 24 hours they can work. But capital intensive is disadvantage, high setup cost, maybe inflexible sometimes. But labor not like that, guys. Labor you can cheaper, and then also people can make sometimes difficult to manage because they're asking holidays and sick leaves and everything they're asking. Just go through this advantage and disadvantage also. So so mainly we talk about those factors. I think our revision program is okay. We have okay with our revision program. So all the lessons so far we have done, we complete. So mainly our revision process is successful. So go through my old handouts, go through my revision tracks, go through my short notes and everything. I'm sure, pretty sure you can go for a successful grading. Okay, then from that I'm winding up this session. So thank you very much for everyone.